The word of God is alive and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and the spirit and the joints and the marrow. And it is a critic of thoughts and intents of the heart. All scripture is God-breathed and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God might be mature, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth, or accurately handling the word of truth. Dear brethren, the life that we are going through is of very, very, very precious. And this life, particularly after knowing Christ, each and every day, if you have not been given number one priority for Bible doctrine, that meant to say you are wasting the world's greatest wealth of all time. That wealth is a spiritual wealth. The entire money put together to buy that wealth, it is not possible for you to buy. It is only possible for you to buy that wealth only when you are there under the mental ministry of Lord God, the Holy Spirit, so that the pastor teacher who is teaching you up, you can acquire that wealth in a day-by-day process. And that is what you will be wasting if you waste each and every day without the knowledge of Bible doctrine. Because every believer has been given two great royal commissions. Number one, he is a royal priest, and number two, he is a royal ambassador for the Lord. And those royal commissions are that every believer is a priest and every believer is a royal ambassador to the Lord. So that, dear brethren, each and every day, as we just rebound in the fellowship of Lord God, the Holy Spirit, in the privacy of our priesthood, we can get back into the reality of being controlled of Lord God, the Holy Spirit, so that Lord God, the Holy Spirit, can in return teach to us the ministry of Lord God, the Spirit. And this activated human spirit can in return control our soul after being energized by Lord God, the Holy Spirit. And this soul can change the volition issue into the pertaining ministry of Bible doctrine and walk as Christ and walk as and live in Christ to the principle that it is no longer I who lives but Christ who lives in us, the hope of glory, and absolutely to be occupied with our Lord. And furthermore, as we go in a day-by-day process, it is the body which will be striving for mastery can be molded out to reach that Hebrews 5:14. And that is what it is happening today in our pulpits, the negligence. Negligence to know this truth that every believer is a priest. Negligence to know this truth that every believer under his privacy of priesthood should execute this process. And the great royal commissions, what we have in this church age, number one, to be among the many benefits of spiritual royalty, the two divine commissions have been granted to every church age believer. Each Christian is a royal priest and a royal ambassador to the Lord. A priest is a human being who represents himself or others before God in the dispensation of the Gentiles. The head of the household represented the family in matters of worship. The family priest's duties included presenting revealed doctrine and officiating in rituals and animal sacrifices. Genesis 4, 3-5, 8, 20, 14, 18, 22, 13. In the dispensation of Israel, God ordained the Levitical priesthood to serve on behalf of the nation as per Leviticus 8, followed by Numbers 3, 5-10. This specialized priesthood taught Bible doctrine verbally and sermonically through the rituals authorized in the Mosaic law. The Levitical priesthood included only unblemished adult males from the family of Aaron in the tribe of Levi, Leviticus 21, 17 through 21. In previous dispensations, membership in the priesthood was severely restricted. Priests were a small minority among believers. The church age is unique in that the priesthood has been extended to include every believer in 1 Peter 2, 5 and 9, Revelation 1, 6 and 5, 10. In union with Christ, every church age believer belongs to the most exalted of all the priestly orders under the high priesthood of the resurrected Jesus Christ. Hebrews 9:11-14. As a royal priest, each church age believer represents himself before God. Romans 12:1, Ephesians 6:7-8, Hebrews 13:15-16. This is the basis for the believer's spiritual privacy in which he lives his own life before the Lord. Romans 14:4, Romans 14:4, 14:10, 2 Thessalonians 3:11-12. Further, the believer's priesthood is also grounds for offering effective prayer. Furthermore, the faithful intake of Bible doctrine, which is the basis for spiritual growth and the attainment of the spiritual adulthood, is a priestly function. Spiritual growth is a result of the believer's priest's protocol function before God. The setting for the royal priest duties is inside the divine dynasphere. In contrast to the service of the earlier priesthoods at physical altars or in material temples, although the believer is a fully ordained priest at the moment of salvation, his priesthood becomes more effective as he attains successive stages of spiritual growth. The universal priesthood of the church age does not imply total independence of believers from one another. The priesthood and spiritual gifts create a balance. The priesthood emphasizes the individual. Spiritual gifts emphasize the group. Spiritual gifts are divinely given abilities that support the many necessary functions which the local congregation as well as outside the local church in propagating the gospel. Believers as priests have responsibilities both before God and among other believers as well. Every Christian is a priest, but not every priest has the same spiritual gift. The gift of a pastor teacher, for example, enables a believer to accurately study and teach the word of the Lord. This function belonged to the priesthood of earlier dispensations, but in the church age, not every priest has a gift of communicating the truth to assembled groups. All believers are royal priests, but not some royal priests are pastors. The pastors depend on the attendance of hearers. Those who are not pastors remain dependent on the pastor's exposition of the scriptures. Therefore, dear brethren, pastors depend on the attendance of the hearers, but the hearers will depend upon the pastor to clearly explain for them the scripture. Although autonomous before God, believers do not live in isolation from one another. The Christian service of individual believer priests also brings them into contact with other Christians. Here, the privacy of the priesthood treats each individual with respect and precludes sins from gossip, judging, and intolerance. This respect for the individual permits relationship to develop a solid foundation upon personal virtue. In other words, privacy contributes to rewarding relationships with other people. It is not a barrier that excludes others from the believer's life. Each believer priest is responsible for residing in the divine ionosphere, learning Bible doctrine, and living his own life before the Lord. But he does not have to eliminate or distort human relationships to do so. The local church is a place where believers meet to hear Bible doctrine, and wonderful human relationships can develop on the common ground of love for the word of the Lord. And privacy allows each person in the congregation to choose his own activities within and outside the church and to pursue or decline relationships on his own initiative. Therefore, dear brethren, we need to understand this as the first royal commission to Christ. And the second royal warrant operates not toward God but toward man. As a royal ambassador for every church age believer represents our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to mankind on earth. 2 Corinthians 5:20, Ephesians 6:20, and Philemon 9. A close analogy exists between a nation's senior diplomat to a foreign country and the church age believer as God's royal ambassador to man. A nation's ambassador does not appoint himself. Likewise, God appoints the royal ambassador to do his representative on earth. An ambassador does not support himself. Similarly, God supplies all the logistical grace necessary to perpetuate the believer's physical and spiritual life in this devil's world. An ambassador's instructions are given to him in writing. The royal ambassador operates according to the written mystery doctrine of the New Testament. An ambassador is not a citizen of the country in which he serves. An ambassador of Jesus Christ has a citizenship in heaven. That is what Philippians 3:20, the polychema privileges. An ambassador does not reside in his assigned country to advance his own personal interests. The royal ambassador lives to glorify Christ and personally benefits not by following his own agenda but through fulfilling his royal warrant. An ambassador does not take insults personally. The believer does not regard the negative evolution of mankind as a personal insult but continues to faithfully represent Christ regardless of insulting treatment by others. The recall of an ambassador accompanies a declaration of war. When the royal family is removed from the earth of the rapture, the war and tribulation will commence as the next dispensation. Therefore, dear brethren, you need to know what are your royal commissions. Royal commission as a priesthood and royal commission as an ambassadorship. Royal commission as a priesthood towards God and ambassadorship towards mankind. So which way you want to go, you decide because of the great polychema privileges given to us, bestowed graciously in this mystery doctrine of the church age. We shall continue in the next tape. Father, we are grateful for the privilege that was given to fellowship with you through the word. We pray that Lord God, the Holy Spirit will enlighten us in these things and make it a source of blessing and challenge, sovereign Lord. For we ask it in Christ's name, Father. Amen.